Both attorneys have agreed to have another witness in between Mr. Matt Brick's testimony.
Yes, yes, Your Honor. The parties have agreed to take a witness out of order. Mayor Broderson's first witness will be Melissa Snydacker, and she's outside. May I go get her?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I almost forgot. Would you please raise your right hand? Do you swear that the testimony that you provide in this matter will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Proceed, thank you.
Step around this way, please. There are some cords, be careful. The first seat.
Good afternoon. Could you state your name and spell it for the record, please?
My name is Melissa Snydacker. It's spelled S-N-Y-D-A-C-K-E-R. M-E-L-I-S-S-A.
And Ms. Snydacker, can you please tell us where you live?
I live at 516 West 2nd Street, right up the hill.
In Muscatine?
In Muscatine.
And how long have you lived in Muscatine?
We've lived in Muscatine 37 years.
And do you participate in any community activities or board?
I do. I'm on the Arts Council Board, and I've done a lot of school PTO kind of things when my kids were in school.
And have you been appointed to any of these boards by the city?
Yes, I have been, to the Arts Council.
And which mayor appointed you to that board?
I believe that was Mayor Hopkins. It's 3 years ago.
And for that board, what has been your experience in observing the interactions between the center staff and city staff?
I think the Art Center staff is cautious about approaching city.
I'm going to object to the form of the question if you're asking her to talk about what others have said or feel.
Your Honor, I asked her what her experience was in observing the interactions.
And
she's not testifying to her observations.
She's not asked that question, answered that question. Ma'am, confine yourself, please, to the question that was asked.
Your Honor, if she could be permitted to answer the question, I'm sure she would testify to her observations.
If her observations are based upon what others have said, then I object.
The testimony will be received and given the appropriate weight as determined by the council.
Thank you. You can continue to answer what your experience has been in observing the interactions between center staff and city management.
My interactions have only been at board meetings when I go to the Arts Council Board, Art Center Board meetings on the third Thursday of the month. Basically, I see there's concern and there is a caution in approaching the city about things that we need.
And why do you think that is?
Well, I think it's because I know Melanie has said she can't speak to certain
Excuse
people.
Excuse me. This is clearly now hearsay. We're asking, the witness is testifying about what someone else has said, and it's inappropriate.
Your Honor, it's not being offered for the truth of the matter asserted.
Then it's simply irrelevant if it's not being offered to prove the truth of any matter asserted.
We'll allow the testimony to be received and given the appropriate weight as determined by the council.
And Your Honor, if we are going to be making hearsay objections, then going forward, is that something the court will accept with other testimony?
It'll be taken on a case-by-case basis.
Okay. Do you personally have any experience with city staff?
No, I don't.
Have you ever been at any events where city staff has been present?
Yes, I have.
What events would those be?
A year ago, April, and I looked it up on my calendar because I was trying to remember the date. April 17th, a Sunday evening, we were invited to our neighbor's home for dinner. Our neighbor is one of the Chinese businessmen in town, and his parents were visiting from China, and they wanted to have a dinner for some of his friends. And so we were invited to come over. We were there with other people, some of our neighbors, and Dave Gobin and his wife, Bonnie, were there.
And Dave Gobin is city staff?
Yes, he is.
And did you observe Dave Gobin's interactions with anyone that evening?
Yes, I did. My husband and I were out in the yard to begin with when we went over talking to some other Chinese people, and then we were called into dinner, and we were asked to sit at a high tabletop, you know, the four square thing. And Roger Landy was sitting at the table, and Dave Gobin was sitting at the table with his wife. Dave and Roger were having what we thought was a really loud, obnoxious conversation. And at first I wasn't sure what it was about. They didn't stop when we walked in and sat down. They just kept going. Then I started hearing, oh, well, you know, Hopkins didn't win because he didn't even get out and campaign. He didn't take it seriously. He wasn't into it at all, and that's why he lost, and we have a problem, and that's bad. And I believe it was Roger that said, well, what are we going to do? We're just going to be stuck with her for the next 2 years. At which point Dave Gobin said, oh, no, we have a plan. He didn't elaborate on that, but that's what I heard.
No further questions.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Excuse me, I do have cross-examination. Ms. Schneidacker, is Mr. Roger Landy a member of city staff or employed by the city?
Not that I know of, no.
Is he an elected official?
Not that I know of, no.
Do you have some objection to him voicing his private opinions?
No, I don't.
You said that his conversation was obnoxious.
I thought in a social setting, he didn't know how I felt about the mayor or the mayoral election. I thought it was a social setting. They didn't even stop when we came in. It was loud.
So you think you are the responsible for the social setting and what others can say in your presence?
No.
Excuse me. Did you happen to mention to Mr. Landy or Mr. Gobin that you found their conversation, in your opinion, obnoxious?
No, I did not.
So you allowed it to continue?
I believe...
Excuse me, that was my question. Yes or no?
Yes, I let it continue.
These observations that you have about Arts Center staff having concern or caution, is that in the context of a meeting with city staff or the council?
I don't understand your question.
Well, in what context are you making this remark?
I'm just saying what I feel and what I have heard and gathered.
So you have no idea of what context these comments or whatever was made that make you feel there was concern and caution?
We've had
Excuse
a lot.
Do you? Question this is, do you?
Would you repeat the question, please?
Can you tell me in what context you heard these conversations that make you think there was concern and caution?
That's what I was going to say, is we were in the context of discussing a lot of renovations to the Art Center.
Very serious discussions, correct?
Very serious discussions.
And again, in what forum did this take place?
In a board meeting.
And who else was present at this board meeting?
The rest of our board members.
Anyone else?
No, I don't believe so.
And you said that this was generated then some concern about the city staff?
No. I didn't say that it caused concern.
Well, if the Art Center staff, as a result of your observations, has concern or is cautious, you said, with its interactions with the city, then who from the city or how is the city participating in this meeting that leads you to the conclusion that they were cautious and concerned about meeting with the city?
The city funds, partially funds, the Art Center, and the Art Center has to go to the city for budget.
Was the city represented at this board meeting?
No.
Would you agree with me that this issue of funding is a serious issue for the board?
Well, yes.
And are you, you have to help me here, but are you inferring that the city has some responsibility or participation in that funding issue?
Yes, they make out a budget.
So then shouldn't both the city council and the board take very seriously this issue of funding?
Yes, I believe they do.
And shouldn't they be cautious as they approach these issues in terms of what they fund?
Yes.
I have nothing further for this witness.
Just briefly, Your Honor. When you stated that the Art Center staff is cautious in regards to the city, is it about budget discussions?
Basically, yes, I believe it is.
And have they expressed any reasons as to why they're cautious?
No, just having to be careful about who to speak to and how to bring things up to them carefully.
And do you have any opinions about why they are cautious?
I have lots of opinions. I really don't know for sure, no.
And going back to that dinner party, who made the statement about, was it Roger Landy that made the statement, we have a plan, or was it Dave Gobin who made the statement?
It was Dave Gobin who said, we have a plan.
And did you make any inference about what that plan was?
I went home and thought about the conversation and talked with my husband about it because we both thought it was an unusual conversation to have at a social gathering, and especially at a foreign person's home. You know, they might think, they might have some opinion about this too, but did not seem to be a concern to either Roger Landy or to Dave Gobin that they were discussing this quite loudly, and they didn't seem to care who heard them.
When Dave Gobin said, we have a plan, did you make any inference about who we was?
I figured it was probably the city.
No further questions.
Ms. Schneidacker, back to this board meeting and the folks that you observed and said that they had to be cautious. Would you agree with me that the issue of funding requires a certain amount of savvy in terms of presenting your budgets, attempting to demonstrate that you're not wasting public money and it's a serious matter?
Absolutely.
In other words, it's not a cavalier issue, is it?
No, we don't take it as that.
Thank you, I have nothing further.
No further questions.
You may step down, ma'am.
We'll recall Mr. Matt Brick.
Please do. He Is someone going to go get Matt?
We're texting him right at the moment, so he should be up shortly.
Sorry.
Number 16.
Yes.
Do you recall this conversation you had with the mayor?
Yes.
How did that occur? Was that in person or was that email?
I believe that one was via email from the mayor. Actually, there might have been a I know there were emails. There may actually have been a phone call at some point as well, but I know that there were emails.
And what was the, I guess looking at that first sentence, the mayor contacted the city attorney to discuss potential criminal allegations against Councilmember Fitzgerald. You're not saying that the mayor was asking you to file charges, were you?
The mayor was asking me to investigate whether or not Mr. Fitzgerald had committed a crime.
And that was based on some citizen complaint?
Correct, that's what the mayor said.
Showing you what's been marked Exhibit DD.
Thank you.
And her question was, what do you suggest I do about this issue?
Yes.
Did you do anything to investigate that?
I did.
What was your response?
I looked up my response is as stated on page one. I looked up the city code that was at reference and also looked up the criminal elements for extortion, and then responded to the mayor with my email.
Did the mayor do anything further with that?
Not with me.
Do you have any knowledge or that she did anything?
I don't have any knowledge that she did anything or not.
What makes this baseless?
That there's no basis for it. There's no evidence to suggest to the mayor's question about Phil extorting information under false pretenses. That's an assertion, but there's nothing to suggest that that had occurred, and nothing to suggest that what Mr. Fitzgerald did, if anything, was extortion.
That's not her statement. She's just relaying what the citizen told her.
She wrote this email.
Right.
Yes.
A citizen has brought up that they talked to Phil. They said that Phil asked. You see that?
I see the email, yes. I understand your position.
He states that Phil extorted information?
Correct.
Those aren't her assertions. She's just relaying what the citizen had told her.
She chose to relay those and asked me to look into it.
Right.
Yes.
And the violation was what?
Again, at this point, with the mayor, given the discussions we already had about the outstanding open records issues, it was clear...
Well, I'm asking you a specific question.
And I'm answering that, if you would let me, sir.
Well, you're not. You're going off on a tangent. I asked what this baseless allegation was, what she did to violate the code of ethics.
She made a complaint?
You might not like his answer, but let him answer your question.
Well, he's not answering it, John.
He has the right to answer it in any way he's...
He's going off on a tangent. He needs to focus on the question.
Give me the liberty.
You'd like to testify for me, sir? I understand, but you've asked me...
I'm asking you a question.
Well, would you let me answer it?
If you respond to this particular question, I'll be happy to. That's all I'm asking.
The fact that you don't like my question does not mean I'm not answering your question, sir. If you restate it, I will answer your question.
With regard to Phil Fitzgerald, what was the ethics violation?
That the mayor, with an open record, sent an email accusing him or forwarding allegations accusing him of a crime without a basis, without evidence.
Who should she talk to about that?
Again, she can go to the city manager, since this was a complaint that didn't involve the city manager, and if he decided, she could direct it to me, or she could contact me via phone to discuss these things so they would not be part of a public record that could be turned over, similar to how it had happened in the past.
And what was the violation?
Again, the violation was making allegations without any evidence.
What's the code section?
My answer to all these remain the code section under the ethics policy that we've discussed today.
Well, as I told you, I'm going to make sure of that because you say among other things.
Okay.
And I want to make sure that we have it limited to three sentences.
Three sentences, sir?
Yeah.
I don't know the three sentences, which I'm talking to you about section 1.0015 and then section 1.003 subsection 2.
You had said earlier that the mayor and council members have a duty to uphold the law.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? I thought you were done.
No, I wasn't. Go ahead.
Could you repeat the question,
sir? City code is what I said at the end. When I said the law, then I said city code.
That elected officials have an obligation to uphold this city code? Yes, sir.
Is that an affirmative obligation or just an obligation to not break the law?
I don't understand the distinction that you're making, but to answer your question, for the mayor, it's in the city code.
How about for city council members?
I could take a look if you'd like. I believe it's also in the city code for the council.
Is it your opinion that the mayor and council have an obligation to point out violations of the code?
I think in all endeavors, yes. The elected officials have an obligation in good faith to follow up on information they receive.
Number 17. Move to have DD admitted.
Any objections?
DD, did you say, Bill?
Yes.
Yes. No, I have no objections to DD.
We'll accept DD into the hearing records.
So move, Bob.
From this point off, if there's no objections, it will be accepted without any vote.
Why don't we to clarify that for the record? Let's make a formal motion by the councils that if there would be no objection to the admission of an exhibit by either party, that it would be an automatic admission.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Granted.
Got it. Number 17. This was a, was this a formal complaint from the mayor about the open meetings?
Well, I know that you and I have had discussions over the word complaint. She formally submitted allegations against the city to IPIB, whether it's called a complaint or, I think actually on their website it is called file a complaint, but she did contact IPIB and raise allegations.
And what was her concern?
Twofold, that she alleged that the minutes of the city's closed session meetings were not detailed enough and that the closed session minutes were not approved by council in open session.
No, the dismissal. And what did the Public Information Board do?
They dismissed the complaint.
What did they say about the detailed minutes?
The head, she's now the acting head, but at the time the lawyer for IPIB, Margaret Johnson, said that our minutes looked like their board's minutes and that her recommendation was if I could talk to Greg and ask him just to add more detail in the future, and Greg said okay.
And he agreed to do that?
Correct.
And that's at brick number 3, the preliminary order of dismissal.
Yes, that's footnote 2 on brick 3 on page 2.
And what does it say, footnote 2?
Oh. IPIB's deputy director did determine that the minutes could be more detailed and communicated this finding to the city. The city administrator has agreed to make sure that future closed session minutes are more detailed.
And her complaint was about detailed minutes not being detailed enough?
As I mentioned, that was one of her two complaints, that the minutes were in violation of the code and the approval of the minutes were in violation of the code.
And again, the violation in this case is what?
I don't understand your question.
You said making a complaint without evidence was, among other things, a violation of the city's ethics policy.
That's a statement, sir. I seriously don't understand your question. I'm sorry.
Okay. What was the violation of the ethics policy?
Again, the mayor communicating without working through Greg or me first to a public entity, claims that were ultimately dismissed. Again, she's making allegations without evidence. IPIB's decision on this was there was no requirement to approve those minutes in open session, which, had she touched base with staff, we could have addressed it, and that there is no obligation or definition of what minutes and how detailed they need to be. But IPIB said, hey, would you mind making it more detailed? And Mr. Monsonger said, yeah, that's not a problem.
But the mayor stated that to you at the time of the closed session. She stated this, she voiced these concerns during the closed session that you were not keeping detailed minutes. Is that correct?
No, that's not correct. I don't keep the minutes.
But you were there.
I was in the closed session.
And you don't recall her making that suggestion or raising that concern?
I don't recall it, but it's not that I'm saying she didn't say it. I'm saying if she did, I do not recall that.
And so are the ethics policy violations the same? 1.001 Roman numeral 5 and 1.002 section 2?
Yes.
Anything else?
No.
Anything other than those two?
No.
Okay. Okay, held a coffee with the mayor. 18, this is 18. And are you saying that that was a violation because it was not authorized by council?
Correct.
Now, if council people attend this coffee with the mayor and introduce themselves as council members and answer questions, are they also violating the ethics policy?
For doing what? For answering questions? That wouldn't be a violation of the ethics policy.
Well, if you first announce yourself as a council member and then answer a question, would that?
Under the language of the ethics policy, that would not be a violation.
It would not?
No.
Okay. Would it violate the ad hoc committee ordinance?
For them to attend a meeting and talk? No.
Announce themselves as council members and then answer questions.
Again, in theory, if they were to create their own committee and show up and say, I'm a city council member and we're going to talk about those issues, that would be the violation. But you're saying showing up and answering a question asked by a citizen, no, they're allowed, it's as the mayor, out in public for people to ask them, hey, what do you think of this or what do you think of that? So no, that wouldn't be a violation of either of those sections you asked.
So the problem is that she publicizes a meeting and encourages people to attend and ask questions? That's the problem?
As we discussed before, yes, that she created a committee. She doesn't have the authority to create a committee.
Well, how's that a committee?
And again, we can discuss this at length. I say, my reading of it, it's a committee, and I understand your position is it's not. I think you said it was a round table. I understand your position, sir. I just disagree.
What were her disagreements with the council about board appointments? What did she say?
That the council was not, and I would like to start this by saying, I was not in attendance, did not have the opportunity to view or listen to the audio recording, so this is based off what was reported by the press.
Okay, so you don't have any knowledge of this, and we know that the press, we can't accept anything from the press, because that's been twice now that those exhibits have not been allowed because of their untruthfulness or their inability to know whether that's a truthful statement. So do you have any other thing other than what you read in the paper to support this statement?
No, sir.
And her ethics violation is what? Same two?
I didn't hear the end of that.
Is it the same two, the ethics policy violation?
Well, in this one, there's also the among other things, and that would be the idea that she went forward with this meeting that I am saying is in violation of the city code, and I understand you're saying is not. But it would be, in addition to that, the other two sections that you and I have discussed. Mm-hmm.
And the ethics violation is that she disagreed publicly?
It's the two sections that I mentioned, yes. So the language of those two, section 001 and 003, subsection 2.
Number 19. How do you know the mayor contacted city staff without authorization?
The mayor emailed David Gobin, and I was provided a copy of the email.
And was the city administrator CC'd on that?
I believe so. I'd have to look at the email to make sure, but I believe so.
Okay. So that it says, it stated that part of her plan was to begin to have a regular staff meetings. And that's
correct.
A violation for stating that?
Yes, it is.
Why is that a violation?
Because that's not within the scope of her duties. Again, as we've talked about, outside the scope of her duties, she and all the electeds are to work directly with the city administrator.
Did she have staff meetings?
the city administrator notified staff, I believe, that they were not to meet with her, that that was not her duty.
Did she have staff meetings?
Oh, sorry, no, and then for the reason I just gave.
So the violation here is that she said she wanted to have regular staff meetings.
She contacted staff and attempted to set up staff meetings, correct.
And what is the violation of the city code?
As stated in that section, this is a violation of the code requiring elected officials to deal with city staff solely through the city administrator.
What is the code section?
Title 1, Chapter 10, Subsection 2, and then it's subsection E1B.
Number 20. You touched on this earlier. This is the audit that's ongoing?
Correct.
There's been no determination by the auditor? They have not come back with any findings?
My understanding is they have come back. They notified the city manager there would be no major findings, and they wanted to meet within the next 30 days to go over the substance of their investigation. But I do not understand or believe that there's been anything in writing provided by them yet.
The mayor has the right to ask for an audit, correct?
Under the state code, yes.
And so the violation is just of an ethics policy, or are there other violations?
Again, this just the same two things that you and I have talked about before.
Nothing else?
Correct.
Number 21.
Yes.
And we won't get into whether it was a complaint or not. I think we've established that.
And I agree with how you characterized it, sir.
I appreciate it. And the violation here is that she went to IPERS and asked about a staff person and how long they had to be off before they could be rehired by the city.
Again, yes.
Is it correct there is no penalty for the city?
That's what we were notified by IPERS, but honestly, I have never reviewed the IPERS code. That's going off what we were told by the investigator or whatever the person, I don't know their official job title, who contacted the city.
And this Mr. Hill was not gone from the city for 1 month prior to being contracted with, correct?
That I could not tell you.
So what was your involvement in this? Anything?
My involvement was when the city had prepared their draft response to the person from IPERS to review it and then to be included on the email chain in the event the person from IPERS had further questions for either Greg Monsonger, I believe Nancy Luke from Finance, Stephanie Romanoli from HR, and myself.
And again, the ethics policy violation, is there anything more than those two sections?
No, sir.
Twenty-two, second coffee with the mayor. Were you at that coffee with the mayor?
No, but that one, the audio and video was posted online, so I reviewed that.
Why could she not complain that anonymous staff making social media posts was not investigated?
Because it was investigated, and I gave her a response of why we couldn't do anything. That's not accurate to say it was not investigated.
City employees were afraid of their jobs, or afraid for their jobs?
And that was specifically directed to the police chief, who was afraid to talk to her and afraid for his job.
City had done nothing to support her since she was elected.
Correct. Again, as we've discussed, those two sections of the ethics code direct the elected officials not to be publicly launching, I think whatever the language is, attacks or making negative statements about each other.
What was this discussion about the city administrator and council not following the current form of government?
The mayor had said we're a special charter city. And that something along the lines of Greg had too much power or something to that effect, sir.
Are you a special charter city?
Correct. We are.
What about the refusal to answer questions about appointment powers? What was your question?
I wasn't at the meeting. I'm not sure why she was saying that, but I was not aware that people had refused to answer her questions about the appointment powers, and I didn't see that I had ever refused to answer her questions. Instead, she'd asked me when any changes to the code would be done, and could she see them ahead of time, and I responded, I'm working on them. I'm going to try to get them to the city manager ahead of time. And ultimately, I don't believe the city manager provided them to the mayor or the council until sometime either the morning of or right before the meeting.
Was that because you didn't get them to them on time?
I mean, I think it was a combination of, one, it probably took me longer to get them to him than he had expected, and two, he's city administrator is a very busy job, so. But yeah, I will say that it took me longer to get them to him than I had expected, and that I had told him it would.
And these ethics policy violations, again, are the two that you previously stated?
And also, the among other things, is the idea that this is yet another meeting that the mayor had called coffee with the mayor.
And what was the code section of that violated?
Title 2, Chapter 10, Section 1.
You're not alleging that spending campaign funds was any violation, are
well,
you?
Well, there is no and was no active campaign during that time. So, yes, I am alleging that she spent money that she brought in for her campaign, not on her campaign.
What did you do to investigate that?
I discovered that the mayor's obligation to report how she spends her campaign funds is not until after the quarter ended. So I did not become aware of this until after the council had authorized me to go forward with removal charges. So I put this in here as one of the facts for the council in this hearing to determine whether they find it rises to the level of a violation.
So you didn't do anything, is that what you're saying, in a roundabout way?
Well, yeah, I did. I read the code. Code says you have to spend campaign funds on campaign activities. This is not a campaign activity.
Did you call the Ethics Board?
Did I call the Ethics Board? I think I might have called. I did not file an ethics complaint. I think I might have called the Ethics Board, yes.
And they would have told you that there was no violation?
They did not say that.
Just as they told the mayor?
No, that is not what they told me.
So if there is a violation, what would you do about it?
Well, two things. One, it can be part of a removal action like it is here. Or two, if you report it to the Campaign and Ethics Disclosure Board, they can determine the issue and then issue a finding. And if they decide, I'm talking too fast, aren't I? I'm sorry. If they decide it warrants it, they can refer it to the county attorney for criminal prosecution.
Did you do that in this case?
No, as I mentioned, when I learned about it, I was in the process of preparing this removal action. So I moved forward with that. And again, I did talk, I can't remember the attorney's name, but the attorney for the Iowa Public Information Board, and I recall them saying it would take a very long time for the board to move through their process and then to refer it on to the county attorney.
Showing you it's been marked Exhibit RR. You recognize that?
No, I do not.
Was this ever brought to your attention?
I do not believe I've ever seen this before.
Would this be a ethics violation?
This is an admonishment from the Iowa Ethics Board.
Would this be a city ethics violation?
That he filed paperwork with the board late, I don't believe that would be a city ethics violation. Other than there is that catch-all that that you need to keep public perception high. But I think that's two or three under 1.001. But no, filing some document required to be filed with an ethics board, I don't know that that's a violation of our city ethics board or a city ethics policy. Mm-hmm.
But in this case, with the mayor, she never got an admonishment.
Okay.
Right?
That is correct.
Move to have RR admitted.
No objections.
No. We'll accept document RR into the hearing pamphlets. Thank you.
And just to be clear, who's this admonishment, state admonishment directed to?
Thomas Spread and the committee to elect Tom Spread.
So what is the ethics policy violation and any other things that you're alleging in 23?
Well, as we discussed, it appears to be a violation of 68A on campaign funds, but also the ethics violations would be the same two that we've talked about before. And that would be the extent of this paragraph 23.
Okay, number 24. Are you alleging a violation of the ethics policy or the city code?
Yes. ethics policy, the same two sections we talked about before, and nothing else.
And...
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Supel, she'd asked a... And nothing else. Is that... Sorry about that.
And what was the violation? What did she do wrong?
The mayor, again, tried to go after two employees and find them in violation of the social media policy. And at that point, based on what she had provided and the advice I already gave her, I had told her it would be a violation of federal law to go after employees for making comments in their purely personal nature, that they weren't wearing their official hat, they weren't saying, I'm so-and-so with the city of Muscatine.
'25?
Yes, sir.
What's the charge in '25?
There is no charge. There's no alleged ethics violation or any other such thing in that chapter, sir. Paragraph.
The counseling that you refer to in number 25, was that you doing the counseling?
Yes.
Was that in the closed session?
I believe that is another evening where there were multiple closed sessions. I'd have to look at the agenda to be sure, because it may have been another one under 21.9, but if you have the agenda and you can show me, I think it was in a closed session.
I do.
Thanks.
JJ. So which of the two did the counseling take place?
Neither.
What do you mean?
I'm sorry. The counseling did not take place in either of those closed sessions.
When did it take place then?
As I was mentioning when you were providing this to me, there were multiple discussions held, and there was also another discussion under 21.9, general employment conditions, which is not a closed session. It's a strategy meeting exempt from the Iowa Code. These two closed sessions were about things unrelated to the mayor or Mr. Monsonger or anything else, to my recollection. They were about two lawsuits that had been filed by people from the outside pending litigation.
Okay, I don't see on this agenda that you reference any other closed session.
Again, Mr. Supel, it is not a closed session. It's a strategy session exempt from open meetings, so it's not on the agenda.
Did the council meet?
Yes.
But it's not on the agenda.
Well, as we talked about earlier, under 20 sub 17 and 21.9, the council is allowed to meet and have discussions. One for strategy sessions involving union employees, and two for strategy sessions not involving union employees. And again, this was the discussion saying, here's how we're going to handle employees. Everyone work through Greg. We don't talk about anything else. If you want to talk to employees, here's what you do. So we were talking about employment conditions and how moving forward, again, we were going to continue to comply with the city code.
Well, it says here that you cautioned her about exposing the city to liability.
Yes.
And losing insurance coverage.
Yes. I explained to her the importance of working within the city code when dealing with employees.
It's your testimony that that does not need to be noticed when you have a meeting like that?
Yes, that it is not part of the open meetings notice requirements or agenda requirements.
I noticed in one of the previous agendas you had put it on there.
I don't prepare the agenda. It was on there, and it was, as I mentioned at the time, a separate discussion. It was not, I would not go into closed session under 21.9 because 21.9, I do not believe, gives us the authority to go into closed session, similar to 20 sub 17. I know there are other city attorneys in Iowa who do that, but I think 21.5 is clear of what are the sections that you can go into closed session under, and 21.9 and 20 sub 17 are not in that section.
But you were in closed session under 20.9.
No, we were not.
You were just not, that wasn't even a meeting, it didn't exist.
No, it's a strategy meeting,
right,
that's exempt from the open meetings law. So open meetings does not comply, and closed meetings does not comply, or it does not require anything. There's no agenda, there's no minutes. It's a strategy meeting.
Okay. And that occurred before 9/17 on the 23rd, that meeting, or lack thereof?
It was the last thing handled that evening. I do not know what time meeting ended. If the agenda shows the meeting ended at a specific time, 9/17, then it would have occurred after that. Because again, it's not part of the regular meeting, either open or closed.
I move that JJ be admitted.
No objections.
JJ is accepted into the hearing records.
And again, 25, there's no charge levied here?
Correct.
Is there a violation alleged here?
Again, this is like the other board appointments. There is no violation alleged here.
Again, are you alleging that there's some impropriety in her spending money from her campaign?
Yes, on non-campaign items, yes.
But you did not get a ruling on from that, from the ethics, and you didn't
Correct.
Follow that up? Okay. And so what were the ethics violations then?
Well, this would have been 2 weeks after the council approved 14 of her 17 appointments. She sent a letter providing the personal telephone numbers of the council members, and again followed up on her previous letter about the city council, for lack of a better term, bullying her, and well, that she wanted the citizens to let people know that they weren't going to tolerate it.
She said that in the letter, that she was being bullied?
Would you like me to refer to the letter?
If that would help you, yes.
All right.
Brick number four.
And could you repeat your question, please?
Would you read that back? I guess I can't remember what it was exactly. No, this isn't it.
That's not the letter. She said that in the letter that she was being bullied.
Oh, was that a question? Okay. It's a four-page letter, but I did look through. I'm not sure that the word bully is in there. But it's, again, the mayor saying the good old boys are attempting to destroy the office of mayor in Muscatine. Simply put, some councilmen are offended by diversity and open government. They're having a meeting to discuss a resolution stripping away all of the mayor's powers and giving it to an unelected bureaucrat.
Are you alleging that providing the phone numbers and email addresses was a violation?
I just find it interesting that the mayor did not provide her phone number, but yet she provided the phone number of the other elected officials. But no, as a separate violation under here.
I mean, those were on the city website, right?
That I could not tell you.
I'm going to show you what's been marked KK.
Well, thanks.
I'm sorry, Katie, I didn't hear you.
Mr. Fred had something to add to the testimony.
Just that I found the word bully on the front page of the letter.
I apologize for my error. It appears to be the third paragraph on the first page where it says, please arrive early and join your neighbors as we stand up to the bullies and fight for free and open local government here in Muscatine.
Would you compare these phone numbers to the letter in KK?
I can, but if you want to tell me they're the same, I have no reason to doubt you. I've never looked at it, and as I testified, those phone numbers themselves are not a violation.
Offer KK into evidence?
No objection.
KK is accepted as evidence.
And the violations for paragraph 27 are what?
The two ethical issues that we've talked about before, the section, subsection 5, and then the other one, subsection 2.
Paragraph 28. Were you present for this interview?
No, I was able to listen to the interview. No, I was not present for this one. I apologize. There's a couple interviews with the press. If I remember, looking at the date, I believe this was the one where Dave Gobin was present and forwarded me an email from him about what he witnessed. But I did not have personal knowledge of this.
How did the mayor contact city staff directly?
I believe this again was another email to Dave Gobin with, Mr. Monsonger being CC'd and telling Mr. Gobin she was going to get involved with the plans for the proposed city river port.
And this violation is what?
Is the violation of the code section we've been talking about, that the elected officials are to work through the city manager when dealing with staff. But no other violations. no ethics violations or other things that you and I have talked about in this paragraph.
Number 30. Did you talk with Jeff Sorensen?
I received a statement from Jeff Sorensen, and I attempted at the mayor's request and Greg Monsanger's request to contact the, I think it was Andrea Flick and Deanna Fleming, but neither of them would ever return my calls.
So you have no personal knowledge about number 30?
I was not there in person, correct.
Is there a charge?
There is no sentence at the end of this on whether or not there's a charge.
Okay, I recognize that. Is there a charge?
Yes, that this would be a violation if the evidence at hearing came in that this in fact took place, but.
Well, what's the charge that you're alleging in paragraph 30? You drafted this.
I did draft it. The charge is that, as with all of these, the mayor is acting outside the scope of her authority. She cannot put her mayor hat on and call where her mom lives and ask them to make changes and hold spaghetti suppers and do things, again, identifying herself as Mayor Diana Broderson. But as I mentioned to you, there is no charge listed on here because this is one of those items that I did not have personal knowledge. I only had what I was told by Mr. Sorensen, and I could not independently verify it.
Number 31. What was your involvement in this?
I was contacted by the county attorney who wanted to talk to me about this issue and wanted to know if I was aware the mayor had met with him, and he was concerned that the mayor was attempting to move forward with criminal allegations against members of the press.
I'm showing you what's been marked MM.
Thank you.
Did the county attorney share that with you? Were you aware of this email?
Yes, I believe this was one of the things Mr. Ostergren provided me.
She's just asking him to investigate this, right?
As to whether or not it's a criminal action, yes.
Right. Or what's it say at the bottom?
Please investigate and determine if there is any criminal activity in the above behaviors, and thank you for your assistance.
How about the sentence before that?
As I mentioned on the phone this morning, I am unsure if this is a criminal act or a civil matter.
Offer MM.
No objections.
MM, what will be accepted as evidence?
And again, what's the ethics policy violation?
Again, it would be those two subsections we have talked about and nothing else.
Were you involved in this? This is the inquiry as to being excluded from closed session.
Yes, I was contacted by the Iowa Public Information Board after the mayor had contacted them.
And this says that a complaint without evidence is a violation of city's ethics.
Filing the complaint and making a public allegation against city elected officials and city staff. Again, it violates the city's ethics policies, and as I mentioned before, these complaints had no evidence to back them up, nor did the mayor follow the channels to talk to anyone on the city to find out before taking staff time and IPIP staff time to determine whether or not there was any violation.
Was she excluded from a closed session?
Yes, she was.
So to file a complaint saying that I was excluded from a closed session, I mean, that's evidence, right?
No, it's not evidence. When the law allows someone to be excluded, and they're excluded, it's not a violation of the Iowa Public Information Board if a city council follows the city or the state code.
Well, that I understand. It's the question about saying that there was no evidence.
Correct. And as you emailed me at the time, and I said, the code allows it, there's no evidence that she was improperly excluded.
And why was she excluded?
It was stated at the time of the meeting. I was not in the regular meeting. I was only in attendance at the closed session. So I would have to defer to whatever the minutes say.
Pardon me? I'm sorry. I didn't understand what you just said.
I wasn't in that part of the meeting when the council made their statement about why she was being excluded. So I would refer you to the minutes.
Well, it says you were discussing strategy with council about litigation.
In closed session, yes.
Would that be about her?
No. No, I actually, will you show me the agenda? I thought that was the one meeting where it was about 21.51I to discuss the appointment, hiring, or performance of a person, and they request to go into a closed session.
Okay, well, let me show this. Maybe this will. NN.
NN.
So why was the mayor excluded?
The same answer I've given you before, sir. It's in the agenda, or it should be in the minutes. It was made during the open meeting, of which I was not a part of. It was not made during the closed session, of which I was a part of.
So this was to discuss if you see in the last page, number 23582.
Last page, oh, thank you.
Of NN.
23, what was the number?
582.
Okay. Yes, I see that.
Okay.
Councilmember Natvig made the motion.
And so the purpose of this closed session was to discuss these charges that we're dealing with today?
No.
What was the city going to sue her about then?
I'm sorry, why do you, that's an assumption that's not based on anything I've said.
Well, finds that her presence of the creates a conflict of interest if she's a potential adverse party.
The city was not intending to sue her, and that was not the basis or reason we went into closed session.
Well, who was she an adverse party to then?
City Administrator Greg Monsonger. At that point, we had been contacted by his attorney. He had raised some potential claims he was saying he was moving forward with, and I wanted to update and brief the council on that.
And Greg Monsonger was there?
Yes.
And you were discussing strategy with the plaintiff?
Strategy, no. I was updating them on the information we'd received from Mr. Monsonger and his attorney, and then we were also talking. It was another discussion about Mr. Monsonger's performance, and he had requested the closed session pursuant to that 21.51i.
Well, look at 21.51c of the code. I think you still have it there.
Point
five.
Okay.
1C.
Okay.
What does that say?
To discuss strategy with counsel in matters that are presently in litigation or where litigation is imminent, where disclosure would be likely to prejudice or disadvantage the position of the governmental body in that litigation.
Okay, well, you said you didn't discuss strategy with them?
No, I talked to them about, there was no lawsuit that had been filed. We knew the lawsuit, or had been told, was imminent. So I was giving them an update on the litigation and wanted to do so in a way where its disclosure would not prejudice or disadvantage the position of the city.
So you talked to them in front of the plaintiff?
Yes.
In closed session?
Yes.
So as not to disadvantage the city as to the strategy that the city may be using in the upcoming litigation?
No, you keep putting that word in there. There was no strategy because at that point, the actual claims had not been filed. It's difficult to prepare a strategy when you know generally what the claims are, but not actually what they are.
And my concern is that the only reason you're going to closed session is to discuss strategy with counsel. And I'm just not sure why.
Well, actually, there are multiple reasons.
But and not
they're listed
for
in 21.51.
Well, I'm sorry, then maybe there was another reason. Do you want to explain that to me? I'm talking about this reason that was given.
There's three reasons that are given. You're identifying one of those three reasons, and I'm telling you, I understand you're using the word strategy, and again, maybe it's yet another time where you and I are agreeing but disagreeing over the word, and I probably should have asked you what you meant by strategy. I did go into closed session with the council. We did talk about the updated information we received, and I wanted to let them know about that information. If that is strategy, then yes, I talked to them about strategy. But we didn't actually have the lawsuit, and so to me, strategy means this count is saying this, and so what we need to do is find this witness, or more detail is what I would describe strategy as. And I apologize for my confusion.
And OO, again, this is another closed session.
Yes.
And same thing?
Correct.
Also to discuss strategy with the potential Greg Monsonger lawsuit?
Yes, we went in under 21.51IC, or however you say that. Sorry, 21.51C.
And the mayor was excluded. Is that correct?
Correct.
And was Mr. Monsonger allowed in that meeting?
Yes.
Offer NN and OO?
No objection.
accepted NN and OO for the hearing records.
Number 33. And for the record, my middle initial is J, not M. I assume you're talking about me.
Correct. Thank you.
Is that your mistake? Is this a charge, number 33?
No.
Mayor contacted Muscatine County Attorney to discuss criminal charges being filed. Tell me about this. What was your involvement in it?
I was contacted by the county attorney, and I know it was subsequent, obviously subsequent to the mayor's discussion with the county attorney, but a few days after his conversation with the mayor, to let me know that the mayor and I believe you had both contacted him about criminal charges against the city council, the city manager, and myself for violations of chapter 400.1. And he let me know that he had reviewed it, did not find that any criminal charges should be filed, and then subsequently he contacted me to say that he'd gone to the Attorney General to get a clarification email or letter because he was concerned that the mayor had been telling people that the Attorney General had directed the county attorney to file and move forward with charges and that the county attorney was ignoring a direction from the Attorney General. But again, this is all information I received from the county attorney. I was not present in those meetings.
Are you sure that Alan Ostergrid said that the mayor was saying that he was directed to file criminal charges, or was it somebody else that he had heard was saying that?
My recollection is that he was saying it was the mayor and he was concerned, but that was several months ago, so it is definitely possible that he might have been saying it was someone else.
I'm showing you what's been marked QQ.
Thank you.
Are you familiar with this letter?
A copy of this letter was provided to me by Alan Ostergren in December of 2016. I've seen it before.
And the long and the short of this letter is that changing the mayor's appointment duties under Chapter 400 for Civil Service Commission was a violation of Chapter 400?
Yeah, the response of the Attorney General to this state senator in Mount Pleasant was that, as you said, correct, that it was a violation of Chapter 400.1.
And that failure to act in accordance with Chapter 400 constitutes a crime?
Yes, that's what this letter says.
Has the city done anything to change their code section with regard to appointments of civil service?
No.
And why is that?
Because the city has gotten a legal opinion from me that we are not in violation of Iowa Code Chapter 400.1. It's a legal opinion I gave to the mayor in March of 2016, and that I continue to say that is accurate and correct.
And just the county attorney and the AG's office got it wrong?
Not that they got it wrong, but again, your law is only good as your facts, and if you get half the story, you can only get half of the story right. So, yes, I would say, based on the information that may or may not have been provided to them, they found it was a violation. Based on the information I have, which presumably is different than theirs, I do not see that it's a violation. And in any event, if it is a violation, then the mayor has actually committed two criminal violations under that code section.
Offer QQ into evidence.
No objections. I believe they're already in evidence as part of Ostergrin.
Just double checking it.
Accept QQ document for hearing records.
And the violation here is that the mayor contacted the county attorney?
That the mayor publicly made allegations to the county attorney, and the violations are those two that we talked about before and nothing else.
Is this a violation? Is this a charge?
There is not a, well, yes, it is a charge that under 68A, she used campaign funds to pay for her personal attorney when no campaign was ongoing. That would be a violation of Chapter 68A if the council, if the evidence came in and the council determined that.
You never checked with the ethics board about whether that's a violation? You never ran this by him?
As we talked about earlier, I believe I talked with the attorney for the ethics board. It's a woman, and I do not remember her name. But no, I did not get any sort of legal opinion, nor did I file anything with the ethics board.
Are you being paid?
Yes.
Today?
Yes, I'm paid when I work for the city.
You said you get paid when you think about working for the city, right?
Yes.
And tell me, then, is the counsel to the council, is he also a member of Brick Gentry?
Yes. Patrick Burke is an attorney with Brick Gentry.
And is he being paid today?
Yes.
Okay. And how about Ms. Hansen?
Catherine Hansen is a paralegal with Brick Gentry, and yes, she would also be being paid today.
Talked about counseling the mayor about her ethical obligations. Did you do the same with city council members?
It was a meeting where all of the electeds were present, and I said to all of them what their obligations were.
Have you ever counseled or warned any of the council members about their actions specifically?
For the city of Muscatine, no. I don't believe I've ever counseled any of them. I've been city attorney, boy, I'm not sure how long, but no, I would say I have not. This council or previous councils.
don't have anything further.
Thank you. Mr. Brick, I apologize. It's been approximately 10 days since you were under direct examination. So I'm going to sort of back up the discussion today, starting where Mr. Supel just left off, and go back through his examination, starting at the end and work backwards, if you don't mind.
Okay, I may need to ask you for another break. I probably need to take a little more allergy medication, but if it's, I don't want to hold you to it. All attorneys say just one question, but if it's going to be more than 20 minutes, would it be possible to take a break?
Would it be okay if we took a break at the moment?
Absolutely.
Thank you. I'll be right back.